Good morning, Saints. Pastor George Mosena here. Good morning, everybody. I know that many of you, you know, it's quite an effort to wake up in the morning, and especially on this winter morning, it's always quite an effort for us to wake up. But I'm grateful that, you know, we know what we are supposed to do, and this is the best that we are to do. And so good morning to everybody. I'm not going to be mentioning all of you here, but you know, I know that many of you here are regulars, but good morning, good morning. I really just want to, you know, step straight into the Word of God and have some time of prayer. So if you, hello everybody, if you have a friend here that you know that they are not here this morning, or they are not awake as yet, and so please, you know, you can send them a WhatsApp or you can send them a message, whichever way that you can communicate with them, and just say to them, hey, listen, wake up, wake up, wake up. It's time for prayer. It's time for prayer, because a time for prayer is a time of power. A time for prayer is a time of freedom. You know, you and I, when we pray, that's when we, you know, experience such great breakthroughs. I believe that, you know, God wants us to have fellowship with Him through prayer. As we fellowship with Him through prayer, we're going to experience greater and mighty things. Greater and mighty things are coming our way. You know, I know many of us, you know, are experiencing so many situations in our lives, but it's when we pray that, you know, our minds, and not only just our minds, but I believe, you know, we start making sense out of certain situations, and we start, you know, seeing and experiencing breakthroughs even as we pray. I'm so grateful that you woke up this morning and you are going to be praying with us. Without any waste of time, if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17. I really just want to go into this particular teaching this morning, 1 Samuel chapter 17. Many of you have heard this story, but I really want to just reiterate it, and I believe that God is going to bring some revelation out of this story. We're going to read from verse 20, 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 20 all the way to 26. Let me read in the NIV version. It says, "Early in the morning, David left the flock in the care of a shepherd, loaded up and set out as Jesse had directed. He reached the camp as the army was going out to its battle positions, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines were drawing up their lines facing each other. David left his things with the keeper of supplies, ran to the battle lines and asked his brothers how they were. As he was talking with them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance. And David heard it. Whenever the Israelites saw the man, they all fled from him in great fear." Now, verse 25, it says, "And now the Israelites have been saying, 'Do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his family from taxes in Israel.' David asked the man standing near him, 'What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?'" He says, "What will be done to the man who kills this Philistine?" David asked. And he says, "If I remove this disgrace from Israel, what will happen, you know, to me or to anybody who will do that?" And then he asked the question, a pertinent question, which is what I'm going to talk about this morning. And he says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Basically, what David was saying is saying, "Who is this man without a covenant or an uncovenanted man who is defying the armies of God?" He says, "I understand and I know that Israel has a covenant with God." He says, "I know how powerful that covenant is." And he says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine who defies the armies of God?" You see, today you might be facing a giant. You could be also facing a Goliath in your life. It might be a financial Goliath. It might be a relationship Goliath. It might be, you know, any type of Goliath, whether sickness Goliath, or, you know, or people that are just accusing you of things that you have not done, Goliath. Or it might be, you know, a Goliath of a decision that you have to make. You probably, you know, may be faced with the biggest decision of your life. You don't know whether you should be going forward or you should be going backwards. And these kind of things, as we live here on earth, one way or another, we face our own giants. But you know, God has put in us, you and me, I'm talking about you this morning, you and me have the capacity. We have what it takes to slay our giants. We have what it takes to bring our giants down. But that will happen if you and I understand the transcripts of our covenant. when you and I understand, you know, the kind of covenant that we have with God. I believe that the reason why David was so confident about bringing that Goliath. You know, you need to understand that this man was a giant. You know, Goliath was not just an ordinary man. The scripture talks about him as a champion. It says that, you know, this was a Philistine champion from Gath. So when it uses the word champion, sometimes, you know, we don't understand how big this man was. But we do know from other versions of scripture that says that this man was a giant. You know, that means he was not just an ordinary man. He was an extraordinary man. He did not have the same, you know, muscles as human beings had. He had bigger muscles. Everything about him was big. Everything about him, you know, was probably 3 times, 4 times, 5 times, or 10 times bigger than a human being. But one thing is certain, that David knew, that probably others, you know, did not recall or probably did not know, that when you are walking with in a covenant such as what they had, they were not supposed to be fearful of this man. So what am I saying to you this morning? I am saying the same way that David understood, you need to understand that you have a bigger covenant. You have a better covenant that is not based on, you know, things that are destructible. You are, you know, in a covenant that is based on better promises. This covenant says you are more than a conqueror. This covenant says you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. This covenant that you are in says you are above and not beneath. This covenant says that the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the bringing down of strongholds. This covenant that you are in says your eye has not seen, your ear has not heard what God can do and what God will do for you. This covenant says, you know, I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Your covenant says that the promises that you read about in the Word of God, every promise, whether it's a promise, you know, of healing or whether it's a promise of prosperity, he says that that promise is yes and amen. There is no where God is concerned or where his promises are concerned. So you are in a better promise, or you are in a better covenant, for lack of better word. You are in a better covenant. So don't let any giant in this life scare you. Don't let anything, you know, scare you, because you have a secret weapon, and that secret weapon is your covenant with God. You know, when you are in covenant with God, that means what the weapons that you use, the Bible says, that's why the Bible says the weapons you use are not carnal, but they're mighty through God, because you're in covenant with God. So you have access to God's weaponry. You have access to God's wisdom. You have access to God's, you know, everything that you need. You have access to it. And when you have access to that, there is no match. There is nothing that can match you. No giant in this life can match you, because you have access into that covenant. A weapon that once turned a shepherd boy into a bear-busting, lion-killing, giant-slaying champion. That's what this covenant made, you know, a shepherd boy to be a giant-slaying, you know, a fighter. You know, this covenant made a shepherd boy to be to kill the bear. You know, he said, if I could kill the bear, if I could kill the lion, what about this man? He says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that defies the armies of God? You see, you have to understand that, like David, you too have a covenant. You have to understand that. You know, back in the day, you know, their covenants were done differently from the covenant that you and I have with God, or that we have with Christ. So David had that covenant, but our covenant is better than the old covenant. Our covenant is what we call the new covenant. You know, the covenant that David had offered a wealth of blessings to those who kept it. And the Bible says that those who did not keep it, you know, it offered a lot of curses at the same time. Now, if you read the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, you know, you will start seeing the provisions of that covenant. It says, blessed you shall you be in the city. If you keep my commandments and you do as I told you to do, blessed shall you be in the city. Blessed shall you be wherever you are. It talks about the blessings, the blessing, the blessing, the blessings. Now from verse 16 of Deuteronomy chapter 28, all the way down to verse 68, it also lists a lot of curses to those who were not keeping, you know, their part of the covenant. So it talks about that. But my covenant, or the covenant that you and I have, you know, is based on better promises. Jesus kept the covenant, you know, on our behalf. As far as we are concerned, that covenant, our covenant, or the kind of covenant that we are in, you know, it's between Christ and God. So it was cut between the perfect Jesus, or the perfect Christ who died for us on that cross, you know, and on God. And so we are recipients of that covenant. We are recipients of that covenant, and that's why it is a covenant that is based on better promises. So I am here to let you know that in this new covenant, don't be afraid of anything that comes your way. Now, I know some of you might be saying, but Pastor George, you don't understand, you know, there's so many things wrong that I have done. And that's why there is what we call grace. Grace, you know, is unmerited, undeserved favor that you receive, not based on what you've done, but based on what Christ has done. Christ has done our part of the covenant. He has done our part of the covenant, and therefore you and I are recipients of that grace. And how do we receive that grace? We receive that grace by faith. We receive that grace by faith. And so we don't have to be performing. We don't have to be doing all the cartwheels and doing everything else in order for us to receive, you know, our part of the covenant. We receive our part of the covenant, you know, or we are recipients of this new covenant because of what Jesus has done. So don't let anything in this life intimidate you. Don't let the giant of poverty intimidate you. Come on, somebody. Don't let anything in this life intimidate you, whether it's a sickness that doctor says they can't treat, or whether it's whatever it is. I don't know what you might be going through, but hey, listen to me. Don't let that situation intimidate you. Why? Because you have a blood covenant with Almighty God. And that covenant was cut between Christ and Almighty God. And therefore, you are a partaker of that covenant. So there is no uncircumcised circumstance in this life that can defeat you. David knew better. David says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine who defies the army of God? Now, if you read that entire chapter and you continue, you know, to even chapter 18 and so forth, you'll realize that, you know, ultimately David won that war. Why? Because he understood his covenant. So it doesn't matter your background. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter, you know, what you have done. It doesn't matter where you are and where you are from and all sorts of things. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. All what matters is Christ has paid the price for this covenant, and you are a recipient, you know, of the victory and the blessings and everything that is stipulated in the new covenant. And so you have to understand that. So I want you to go out there knowing that you are a victor. I want you to go out there understanding that you are a giant slayer. I want you to go out there understanding that there is no weapon that is formed against you that shall ever prosper. Why? Because you are in a better covenant. You are in this new covenant. The curse is not part of this covenant. No. The Bible says that you are freed from the curse. Cursed is everyone that hangeth on the tree, the Bible says. Jesus took the curse on your behalf. So he took the curse so that you can receive the blessing. So you go ahead, you face every giant, understanding your covenant rights. Come on, somebody. I am saying face that those giants, knowing and understanding your covenant rights. Don't be fearful of any situation because you understand your covenant rights. And how do you understand those covenant rights? You go into the Word of God and you go find out, you know, what God has said about you and has in store for you. You go into the Word of God and find out, you know, that which God says about you. And when you understand that part, nothing can stand on your way. No sickness, no disease, no poverty, no relationship issue, no intimidation of any kind, nothing in this life or whatever it is shall ever destroy you or shall ever defeat you. Why? Because you're in a new covenant. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but I believe that God wants you to understand your covenant rights in order for you to be victorious in this life. David was victorious. David brought down the Goliath because he understood his covenant. And he was right. He was right. His giant, the same way as your giant, is an uncircumcised Philistine. That means, you know, he is no match to God Almighty. That's what David was saying. He says he is no match to the one I'm in covenant with. You and I are in covenant with God. Nothing in this life is a match or can match our God, can match our Jehovah Jireh, our Jehovah Shalom. You know, you don't need to have anything that will steal your peace. You have a covenant with God. No one is supposed, and nothing, and no disease is supposed to steal your health because you are in covenant with God. No lack is supposed to be your portion because you are in covenant with El Shaddai. So that's what you need to understand where this covenant is concerned. So this morning, I really want us to pray about this. I want us to pray and say, Lord, help me to understand my covenant rights. This morning, I want you to say, Lord, help me, you know, not to be afraid of whatever I'm facing because I'm in covenant with you. I want us to pray today, you know, even with those kind of giants that you might be facing today. I don't know what giant you're facing today, but I want you to say, Lord, I thank you that even with all of these giants that seems to be so big, I choose to stick with your covenant, and your covenant says, I am victorious. I choose to stick with your word because your word says I'm victorious. And I want you today to turn your eyes from the giant, turn your eyes from the problem, turn your eyes away from your problem or your giants or whatever it is, and turn your eyes to Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Turn your eyes to Jesus, the ratifier of that covenant. And I want you to turn to him and he will see you through this morning. So I want us to pray about that as number one. And number two, I want us to continue praying for our young people. I want us to pray for our young people because, you know, we live in a very interesting time. There's everything that is, you know, there are a lot of things that are trying to lure in young people. And even the older people, even the mature people, adults, we have many choices in the world we live in. And these choices can easily distract us from God. You know, we can choose to spend more time on PlayStation. Come on, young person. You can choose to spend a lot of time, you know, watching things and doing all sorts of things. And we forget the time to be spending with God. And so I want us today to pray that God may help us, you know, to always choose him, to always choose him first, to put him first. Just like Mary, who chose to be at the feet of Jesus instead of having to be preoccupied by other things. So I want us to pray this morning that God may help us in that particular area. And number three, you know, I want us to continue praying for each other. Let's continue praying for each other. You know, the people that you need to be praying for this morning. I want you to continue praying. As you know, we will continue to pray for our country as well, which is number four. We'll continue praying for our country, pray for its, you know, rise, pray for its stability, and pray for its prosperity in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to pray. Are you ready to pray this morning? Hallelujah. Father, we give you the praise. Father, we honor you, for you are wonderful and precious, Lord. You are the great God. You are the mighty God. You are the God that never fails. Thank you for this precious word this morning that you have shared with us, Lord. Thank you this morning, O God, in Jesus' name, for this revelation of understanding that we are in a better covenant. We have a covenant, my God, that is ratified by the blood of Jesus. We have a covenant, O God, that says we are victorious. We have a covenant that says there's no giant that we cannot slay. And Heavenly Father, regardless of the kind of giants that we might be facing today as a people. Lord, I am praying today in the name of Jesus this morning. I pray, God, that every giant that we are facing, oh God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that we may rise up and confess and declare that there is no giant that will ever defeat us, because we have you on our side, oh God. And we can stand like David and say, who is this uncircumcised Philistine or uncircumcised situation that is continually defying the armies of God? And Father, we can stand understanding that, Lord, you are on our side. We can stand understanding that we have a bigger power that is backing us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We can pray, God, understanding that, Lord, you are with us. We can pray, God, and we can stand and we can live this life, Lord, not being afraid, not being timid. We can live, my God, this life with the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. We are not afraid. The Bible says you have not given us the spirit of fear, but you've given us the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. Father, I don't know, you know, what these your people that are praying with me this morning, you know, are facing. Father, I pray that whatever giant they might be facing. Some of them might be facing a mountain, God, of financial giants. Some of them might be facing, oh God, a mountain, Lord, of relationships, roller coaster problems. Some of them, my God, might be dealing with, children issues or spouse issues or whatever. Some people might be dealing with a dry spell or dry situation. Some people might be dealing with stagnation in their life and they don't know whether they're going forward or they're going backward, or they're making any progress. Father, I am praying for each and every one of them this morning. I am praying the Lord, in Jesus' name, whatever giant they might be facing, I pray in Jesus' name that they may understand, that they may settle it in their hearts and understand that, Lord, you are a giant slayer. That they may understand that they have a better covenant. That they may understand, oh God, that with you, Lord, they are victorious. The same way that David understood that with God Almighty, the God of Israel, he was victorious. This morning, Lord, I am praying in the name of Jesus for each and every one of these your people. I'm praying for us that, Lord, the blessings of Abraham, the blessings, oh God, that you have spoken about or showed us in your word, oh God. I pray, Lord, in Jesus' name, that we may understand, that we may be reminded of those blessings and take hold of those blessings in the name of Jesus, understanding that these blessings and these promises are part of our covenant, that we may not let go of that covenant in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you the praise. Father, we give you the honor in the name of Jesus. This morning, I'm also praying for these, my brothers and sisters, Lord. I'm praying for our members. I'm praying, Lord, in the name of Jesus, even for the young people in our church. I just pray, God, in Jesus' mighty name, that, Lord, even in the midst of this plethora of choices that we have to make, even in the middle of, you know, so many things that are facing us and so many voices that are speaking, so many choices that we have to make, Father, I pray that we may choose to make the right choices. I pray that, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that we may look in the mirror of your word, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that we may, Father, choose you, you know, over the things of this world, that we may choose you first, that we may prioritize you, that we may put you first in our lives and not put any other situations in our lives, that we may not put our jobs before we put you, Lord, that we may not put our families or our children, Lord, or that we may not, my God, choose other things before we choose you, Lord. I pray, God, that you be number one in our lives, that you be the first in our lives, Lord, that everything else, my God, may come around us choosing you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, I pray for our young people. I pray that you open up their eyes, that, Lord, they may be hungry for God, that they may choose you, Lord, they may have a relationship with you. Father, I pray not only just, you know, for those, but I'm praying for the adults. I'm praying for the older people, oh God. I pray that they may have a relationship with you, Lord. I'm praying even for young people in our church, House of Faith, Lord. I pray that there may be a revival among these young people. I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that, Lord, you may draw their hearts towards you, Lord. I'm praying in the name of Jesus that let them understand, oh God, who you are. And Father, in the name of Jesus, that they may have want, my God, and desire to have a relationship with you. In the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that their love for you, God, that I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, their hunger and their thirst for you, God, may just keep on growing and keep on growing and keep on growing in their hearts in the name of Jesus. This morning, Father, I'm also praying today. I am praying, God, in Jesus' mighty name, for these, my God, my brothers and sisters. The Bible says that we need to pray for each other. In the book of James, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Father, I am praying this morning for every brother or every sister that is here this morning. Father, I just pray for them in the name of Jesus. Lord, guide them, Lord, direct them, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name, lead them with your mighty hand, oh God. Father, I pray that you reveal yourself to them, Lord. I pray, God, that you answer their prayers. I pray, God, that you open up the doors for them, Lord. I pray, God, in Jesus' name, that you untangle situations that have been tangled for too long. In the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that those that are believing you, Lord, for a turnaround, I pray that they may experience that turnaround, Lord, in the name of Jesus. I am praying, God, that they may seek after thee, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. I'm praying, God, that you may walk before them, Lord. I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that though they walk in the valley of the shadow of death, they may fear no evil, for thou art with them, Lord. I am praying that they may understand that you are their shepherd. They shall not want. I pray that they may understand, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that if they dwell in the secret place of the Most High God, they shall abide in the shadows of the Almighty. I pray that they may understand that their problem and the challenge that they might be having is no bigger than the God in their lives in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that let them be reminded. Let them speak, my God, of how powerful and how great you are in their lives, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, give them breakthrough. Give them breakthrough, my God, in their job situation. Give them breakthrough, my God, in their family situation. Give them breakthrough, my God, even in the areas that they're asking and they're asking for a breakthrough, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name for that single person who is believing you, Lord, in Jesus' name, God, to for their situation and their status to change. Father, I pray that let it change today in Jesus' name, even according to your will. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you may grant their heart desires, Lord. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that they may experience, my God, your goodness in the land of the living in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you. I thank you that in the midst of all of these things, that Lord, we shall see your goodness and we shall see your grace in Jesus' name. Father, I keep lifting up our nation up. I keep lifting South Africa up. I say, South Africa, you shall prosper, I declare this morning in the name of Jesus. I declare that South Africa, that you will continue to experience a prosperity. You will be the light even in a world that is faced with so many challenges, that you will continue to prosper, that you will stand for the truth, and any of the things that are not right and any laws and statutes that have been proclamated in this nation that don't serve, you know, the purpose and the will of God, I come against it in the name of Jesus. I pray that let there be a righteous God, a righteous people. I pray that let there be a righteous government that rises in this nation in the name of Jesus. A government that says we want to see this nation prosper. A government that understand, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that we have to uphold the law of God even more than we uphold our own laws or man-made laws in the name of Jesus. And Father, I still pray this morning that anyone, oh God, that is bringing forth a demonic agenda, a satanic agenda, that agenda that serves the will and the precepts of demonic activity, Father, I pray that you remove them in the name of Jesus. Let them be removed, oh God. I pray that it may be those, oh God, that will propel the will of God over this nation in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you the praise and we give you the honor, for you are wonderful and glorious, oh God, in Jesus' mighty name. This morning, we pray for those who don't know you, God, as their Lord and Savior. We are praying, God, from the east, from the west, from the south, and from the north. I pray, God, that even where our local church is concerned, I pray that they may come from everywhere. Let them hear the word of God and change in their lives in Jesus' mighty name. I'm praying for sons and daughters of our ministry, Lord, those that you have planted in our church. I pray in Jesus for each and every one of them. I pray, God, for whatever their needs are. I'm praying, God, in Jesus' name, that they may connect to that vision that, Lord, you said they must connect to. And Father, that they may not run away from it and not neglect, my God, and not move away from where you have placed them in Jesus' mighty name. We give you the praise and we give you the honor today. And it's in the name of Jesus that I pray. It's in the name of Jesus that I pray. Father, I thank you. Rabba koshele mendarasi telekesa. Mandolobo koshila mandra kasite. Liriba mandolobo koshila mandroposi. Ribebese telebe keshe telebabashia. Liriba mandolobo koshita la mandarasi. Zilendere keshe telebo koriandarabasa. Rebebe geze telebo koshita la mando. Mandiriba kasita la varian. Times of refreshing in the presence of the Lord is what I'm praying for, Lord. Times of refreshing, even where these ones, oh God, that are praying here this morning, I pray that you refresh them, Lord, in Jesus' name. Mandira kasha talabasa. Ribo koshila mandro kosi. I give you the praise and I give you the honor, for you are worthy of all the praise, worthy of all the honor. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for what you have done and what you're going to do. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen and amen. Oh, my goodness. What a time in the presence of the Lord. Man, oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Hallelujah. I know many of you are blessed, even as you have heard that word this morning and even as you have prayed. Many of you are energized. Many of you this morning are refreshed, because times of refreshing are found in the presence of the Lord. And so thank you again for joining us this morning. And we really pray God's blessings upon your life. I really pray that, you know, the Lord may go with you this morning, that the Lord may accompany you wherever you go this morning, that you may experience that supernatural favor even as you go, that you may experience breakthroughs in your life, that no Goliath shall stand before you, for you are in a better covenant. No uncircumcised giant will ever stand before you this day in the name of Jesus, for you are a giant slayer. I know the other week I spoke about giant slayers, but not in this particular fashion. I believe that God is just bringing out something great in your life that, you know, is designed to make you great in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, and God bless. Hey, listen, tonight we are not meeting at the church. There is no service tonight. I know, you know, many of you might be saying, Pastor George, we are looking forward to it. Hey, we have something even better. On Friday, this week, Friday the 9th, I believe, of June, we are having an all-night prayer. We are meeting at our church from 9 o'clock in the evening. So come and join with us. Come with your friends. Come, you know, with your family members. We are having our prayer meeting from 9 o'clock in the evening. We are praying all night. You know, we will be having a great program. We will be having a great time of worship and prayer, a great time of sharing the word of God. So come warm, it's winter. We'll be having some heaters. It'll be a cozy space. We'll be praying, walking around, and just having a great time in the presence of God. So you don't want to miss it. So come with your family, come with your friend. Come. Don't let anything stop you. Don't let, you know, sleep stop you. We all want to sleep, but, you know, this time is so precious. So come Friday, 9 o'clock p.m., and don't miss it, because we're going to have a great time. I'm looking forward to seeing you on Friday, not tonight, but we are seeing you on Friday night at 9 o'clock, right at number 130 Plantation Road, Blue Hills, Midrand. So I'm looking forward to joining with you You know, we're going to have a great time in the presence of God in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you so much. God bless you. Have a great day. And I shall see you on Friday. God bless.